And so it is with great pleasure that I introduce Mr. Andrew Salkin, the Chief Operating Officer of the Rockefeller Foundation's 100 Resilient Cities Challenge. He leads the organization's day-to-day operations and will implement the vision to support cities in preparing for and rebounding from the shocks and stresses of the 21st century. Mr. Salkin joins 100 Resilient Cities from New York City's Department of Finance, where he was the Deputy Commissioner of Operations, managing more than 800 people and responsible for collecting $30 billion annually. In this role, he improved efficiencies and customer service, including introducing web-based payment options. He was involved in a number of transportation strategies, first deputy commissioner of the Taxi and Limousine Commission, if you can imagine what that must be in New York City. It goes on, you know, hallmark projects included equipping taxis with credit card payment machines in New York City's Taxi of Tomorrow competition. I could say more, but that's probably plenty. Andrew's gonna give us an introduction to the 100 Resilient Cities Centennial Challenge and then provide a broader overview on the subject of resilience.
So again, I'm Andrew Salkin. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for the 100 Resilient Cities program. And I'm here tonight to give you two presentations, as the mayor suggested. I'm gonna start with resilience and talk about what resilience is and how we're thinking about it in an urban construct. And then I'm gonna talk a little bit about 100 Resilient Cities, and I think the mayor did a good job of highlighting a lot of what we're gonna be doing, but how we're gonna work with you in Norfolk and what some of the goals are of the program, so you get a sense of how you're playing on the global field. So with that, let's get into resilience. So resilience is one of those words. I think everyone here in the room is probably familiar with the word, but I think we all bring to it our own background, our own perspective on exactly what it means, right? We can think about individuals being resilient. My son, who's six, broke his leg last fall, and I was told how resilient he is in overcoming that stress. We can think about resilience in the sense of ecology, and we think about natural systems and their ability to maintain and recover functionality. I know many people here work in government, and if you're like my experience in government, you've had your IT engineers talk about resilience of the IT network and how important it is that we return to business as quickly as possible. But more and more, we're starting to think about resilience in a greater sense, right? The sense of a community, and how is a community really come together. And if you think about that as a system, and we think about that system as a city, it starts to help us frame where we're going with urban resilience and city resilience. So this idea that resilience isn't something that we are today and it's a static way of being, but it's something that we should be practicing and evolving and maturing over time, so that what we're practicing tomorrow is certainly not what we're practicing today, and what's resilience tomorrow is certainly not what we're doing today, is critical to think about. So this idea in this chart here kind of shows that is the blue line represents the city. A city, and let's just say it's going on its pathway and everything's good, but bam, a shock happens, right? How well does that city recover from that shock, and how quickly does the city get onto its trajectory that it was traveling, right? Or is the city organized in a way that allows it to leverage the shock so that it can exceed where it was before and actually develop a new pathway of success, a new way of doing business, a way that maybe it never thought of doing business before, but one that is even better than where it was? So is it set up in a way that it can leverage shocks and stresses to improve itself? Or conversely, is the city set up in a way where a shock and stress brings it down and it can't quite recover to where it was, and now it's more susceptible, and another shock happens, and yet maybe even a third shock, and maybe that third shock is just a little thing that no one would have noticed before, but now the city's functioning at such a low level that it spirals down even further. So this is this idea of resilience. And what we're thinking about here is we're thinking the city's ability in the face of shocks and stresses to maintain essential functions, all right? Maintain essential functions, but not only maintain essential functions in the face of shocks and stresses, but also to evolve and emerge stronger than it was before, okay? So this is what we're throwing out as a good definition of resilience. And I think in order to think about this, we have to touch upon two components of this definition. One is essential functions, and that's something that I'm going to introduce in a couple slides and lay out a framework for what we think essential functions are for a city. But I think it's also important that we take a moment and think about shocks and stresses. And I think the mayor did a great job of outlining some of the shocks and stresses that you have here in Norfolk. But let's think about them for a second here. We've set it up with shocks on the right-hand side, and those are things that you can see, you can touch, you can feel, right? A hurricane comes, you know it's here. You can go outside and see the damage. When a fire happens, you know it happened. You see the impact, you can go out and see the damage. And when there's a shock like that, communities like yours can come together and find resources and rebound and work hard to recover. But also facing cities at the same time are these chronic stresses. The mayor talked about poverty, that's a big one. You also have aging infrastructure. You have high unemployment rates, which I guess goes with poverty. You have education. You have water pollution. You have crime. These are things that if you think about it, right, cities are battling every day, right? We drove around, I got an opportunity to drive around Norfolk today. I saw new water lines being put in. I saw streets being rebuilt. I saw roadways being raised. These are the things that you do every day to help maintain your resilience. In a lot of ways, you don't call it resilience, you just call it doing business. But that's you fighting off those chronic stresses, right? So if you think about the city, and there it is in that little model, it's getting pounded by chronic stresses and has the threat of these acute shocks coming out at any time. And if the city's able to organize itself correctly and plan and think around those challenges, we believe that the city can develop a resilience model that will help it survive whatever gets thrown its way. So let's take a quick case study. And this is just something to kind of help further our thoughts. We heard a little bit about Norfolk, but let's talk about Turkey. Van Turkey is a city that decided it needed to do some economic development, and they were able to lure Toyota into building a plant. One of the concerns Toyota had when they built that plant was that Van's susceptible to earthquakes. So they told their engineers, let's build a facility that can withstand any earthquake that may come our way. So they built their facility, and looking at this picture, this is what the facility looked like after the 7.1 earthquake happened in 2011. So from some perspectives, we'd say the engineers were successful in establishing resilience. But was it really resilience? So what I also want to draw to your attention on the picture, and this is something that really strikes out for me, on the right-hand side, there's a highway, right? I don't know the last time you ever saw a highway that was completely empty, but something's going on. And what's going on is devastation, right? Thousands of people were injured. 11,000 plus homes were damaged. Critical infrastructure was disabled. Prisoners were running around the streets because prisons were damaged. The city of Van was not resilient and isn't functioning at a high level. That Toyota plant, while maybe it's standing, it's not functioning either. It's not open. So the idea is, were they resilient? Was this community resilient? Well, I think it leaves a little bit for us to think about. Well, maybe it wasn't. So now I want to get to the essential functions. And this is this notion that the city is engaged in performing its essential functions every day. And what we're arguing is that a city that does these essential functions better is more resilient. All right. So let's walk through this a little bit. First, I want to point out the city is spelled with a lowercase c. Right? And that means it's not city government's job to be resilient, but it's the whole city's job to be resilient. All the sectors, all the stakeholders, the individuals, all the way up to the largest institutions. It's everyone's responsible to help build resilience. So let's start at the top. Meets basic needs. This is transportation, food, shelter, water, education. A city that's able to do this well is a city that's going to be more resilient. Think about it, right? Transportation that's functioning, that has multiple options, that provides ways for people to get around in times of stress, as well as times of as the city develops and doesn't create chronic traffic jams, is a city that's going to be more resilient. Safeguard human health and life. This isn't just about protecting people when there's a disaster. This isn't just about protecting people from crime or having good hospitals. It's also about building codes and setting up a regulatory structure that allows the city to protect its people in normal course of business. All right, a city that practices this better is going to be a city that's more resilient. The mayor talked a lot about assets, both human, man-made, and natural assets. A city that is able to ensure that its assets are able to aid in perhaps an evacuation of the city when the time comes, but also a city that's able to build its natural assets in a way that helps mitigate the damage of a storm as it comes into the city, right? A city that's able to protect its assets is a city that's going to be more resilient. All right. Something that Norfolk knows really well and something we've learned a lot as we've begun to work with you is a neighborhood, is a community that has strong neighborhoods and a city that has neighbors that know each other when times are good is going to be a city that's able to help each other when times are bad. And the idea of building neighborhoods and building capacity at neighborhoods is critical for any resilient strategy. And this is something that Norfolk does well, and it's something that we think resilient cities do well. Enforcing the rule of law and justice, this spreads out through all of the functions. It's not just about law and order and crime and justice and fairness. It's also about making sure those building codes are enforced, because you can have great building codes, but if they're not enforced, the buildings will fall down if there's a disaster. It's also about setting the rules and helping making sure that the private sector understands how to engage with the city so that when they come to town to make investments, there's not people getting certain favors or certain things happening that allow one person to succeed and not another, right? This idea that cities that practice rule of law and practice justice better are going to be more resilient cities is also important. Something that's becoming more and more important is this idea of sharing and generating information. This isn't just data that's being produced now and being shared with the public, and that's something that Norfolk's doing a great job of, but it's also allowing for the dialogue amongst different constituents to allow for innovation, taking that data and turning it into information that can be utilized to make decisions. This is becoming more and more important in our cities, and cities that do this better are going to be more resilient cities. Livelihoods. We all have to live here. We all have to live in the cities. We all have to work and provide for ourselves and our families. We all need time for recreation and relaxation. Cities that provide for a well-rounded livelihood, well, those are cities that are going to be more resilient. And finally, this larger overarching scheme of economic prosperity, right? Think about it. A city that allows and opens itself for development and private investment, well, guess what happens? More private investment follows that, more economic prosperity. It becomes somewhat of a self-fulfilling prophecy. So a city that is able to practice this better, and this is something I think Norfolk works real hard at and has done amazing work on over the last many years, this is a city that is going to be more resilient. So I present these functions as individual functions that a city does, but if you think about it, it's what you're doing every day, all the time. You're doing these on multiple levels simultaneously. And it's your ability to understand how these mix and match and work together that will help determine your ability to become more resilient. Moving on from the functions, it's kind of like, well, how do you do that a little bit? And so we offer these qualities. How does a city begin to think about itself, and how does it organize itself so that it can enhance those functions that we think are so critical? Well, the first three here are really a state of being and a state of mind, right? Resilience, in many ways, is about accepting the unknown. You can make predictions about floods, you can make predictions perhaps about economic times, but there's things you can't make predictions about or you don't have time to, right? I know your neighbors probably didn't predict that they'd have a chemical spill that would make 300,000 people not have water for several weeks. In the Gulf, they worry about hurricanes, and they probably really weren't thinking about oil spills. And I know here in Norfolk, you probably weren't really planned for a snowstorm that you had several weeks ago. These are the kind of things that we know are going to happen. Stresses and shocks are not what you plan for. And unfortunately, it's exactly what we have to plan for is the unknown. So how do you do that? Well, you do that by being reflective and adaptive. You begin to learn from the past, and you take those lessons and you apply them for the future. And you start to plan and strategize and make your city, you use this framework to help you organize your city. So the next three are about organizing your city, this notion of how do you organize your city around this notion of being robust, leveraging the resources that you have so you can have diverse delivery of systems, you can have efficient delivery of systems, that systems are actually able to work across each other and provide diverse solutions and delivery models. This idea that you're beginning to organize yourself in ways that maybe you've never done before, where you begin to cross sectors, and you cross the silos that exist within these sectors, right? But all of the state of mind and the organization of the city, for all of this, you have to also integrate your thoughts And you have to be inclusive. You have to include all ideas and people. You have to integrate ideas and thoughts. You have to prioritize the different competing ideas and needs. And you have to prioritize your solutions. And if you're doing this all together, we think these qualities will help aid in your ability to be more resilient. And we kind of put it together, we have this pinwheel of resilience, if you will, where the essential functions are what the city's doing every day, and the qualities are what the city brings to bear and how it manages and thinks about these tasks. So now I want to give two more case studies of cities that have successfully changed, all right? So the first one's a tale of two blackouts. I'm picking member cities here. New York City is a member city, and in 1977, they had 2 days with a blackout. And what happened? Well, chaos happened. People were roaming the streets. This is a picture of a gentleman who's actually stealing street furniture off the street. Law and order is ruined, right? This city is not resilient. Fast forward to 2003, 2 days of blackout, same story, different answer. The city is organized, people are walking home, people are milling about doing their business, and everything's basically calm. I have a lot of friends who said that was the most fun they've ever had in New York because everyone came together and it was like a big block party. I was working at the Department of Transportation at the time and I was standing on a street corner directing traffic. So I did not have fun, but it was an interesting experience. So the question is, what changed between 1977 New York and 2003 New York? Right? So let's look at the functions a little bit. One of the things that happened was the city was in terrible budget straits. There's a famous news article, Daily News headline that says, President Ford to New York City dropped dead. And that's because they weren't getting bailed out. So the city had to change the way it practices budget and finance. And this goes into generating and sharing information. So they became transparent. Decisions became something that the public was actually engaged in, and it helped realign spending and resources around things that people cared about, which actually helped the city begin to think about its economic prospects. It helped the city reorganize its zoning laws. It led to the rezoning of Times Square. It led to the cleaning up of the transportation system and the removal of the graffiti on the subways. It led to the organization and reorganization of our policing and new community policing models that opened up the neighborhoods again, that led to the livelihood of the communities. So as you see, New York completely reorganized itself, and in fact, over time, and maybe it took, you know, not 5 years, but maybe it took 25 years, it effectively changed. And New York today, right, is a city that can withstand terrorism, transit strikes, blackouts, economic downturns, and superstorms, right? This is not the same city that existed in 1977. Another member city also has gone through some transformation, and this is Medellin in Colombia. We were there a couple weeks ago. In 1980s and 90s, Medellin was the heart of the Colombia drug cartels. The Medellin cartel, run by Pedro Escobar, wreaked havoc and fear throughout the city. In fact, government had failed so much that this gentleman here was paying for the libraries, was paying for the infrastructure, was giving the money to the churches. Some would say he was a hero. Others would say he was a vicious criminal. So how did this happen to Medellin? Well, Medellin has an interesting story, right? Its physical layout is that the economic activity is in the valley by the river, and then up in the hills are the neighborhoods. And by the neighborhoods being separated, it gave the art cartels and the gangs and the drug lords the ability to take over neighborhoods and kind of fight out against each other. There's stories of one neighborhood hilltop fighting another hilltop for control of some drug trade or another. So the city began to think about, how can we take back our city? So, right, let's go back to the pinwheel and start thinking about it. Well, they started to do integrated projects, and this is one that I think really hits home the multiple facets. So what you're looking at here is a transportation solution. This is an escalator. This is an escalator. If you see, it's the orange that takes you zigzagging up the hill. It takes the neighborhood that's up on top of the hill, down the hill to where the jobs are, and takes you back and forth. So first, they start with a transportation, livelihood, access kind of project, but they don't stop there. See that big building up there? Well, that's a community center. So now they built a community center within a community, within a transportation project. And if you see at the tippy top, there's two people in red. Well, those are people from the community watch. So they put the community watch to combat violence in the middle of this community center. And they added some beautification with the mural and plant life. And now you have a situation where you're tackling multi-circles on the function chart at the same time. And this is the kind of thing that they began to do to take back the neighborhoods, right? And this isn't something they just do for an escalator. They've extended that concept to now include aerial transit, right? So this is, now they're linking further flung neighborhoods into the economic core, but the same model is being practiced here. I don't know if you can see in the lower left-hand corner, there's a big building kind of down there, the gray slab. That's the community center that's part of the station for the gondola. So now there's a community center that's a place of where the community come together. They come together at what? The lifeline that links them back into the economic activity. But this gondola also links hilltop to hilltop. So neighborhoods that once used to fight are now 5 minutes away by a gondola. And it's breaking down those barriers. And it's helping that city become more resilient. Now Medellin has a long way to go, but they've made a lot of progress. And they've done it by tackling many of these different functions simultaneously. And they are becoming better at providing transportation and basic needs. They're better at providing safety and rule of law. They've become better at providing livelihood. And now they're getting economic investment. They were named the most innovative city in the world. And they're becoming something that is going to be on the path to maybe a city that doesn't have to worry about falling back into the hand of the drug lords again. So this is the introduction of a framework on how we can begin to think about resilience in the cities, for cities. And these functions are what we're going to be thinking about as we go through the journey of resilience here in Norfolk. Now I want to slide into the next part of the presentation and talk a little bit about 100 resilient cities and how we're going to work with Norfolk over the next several years and how we're going to work in the cities. And the mayor gave a lot of great highlights, so I'll try not to be too repetitive. But about a year ago, the Rockefeller Foundation, realizing that urbanization is something that's occurring throughout the world, right? By 2050, we think 75% of the world is going to live in a city. This idea that what happens to cities is going to impact the rest of us, so the cities must be able to maintain the vitality and functions and faces of stresses and shocks. So how do cities do that? Well, they have to become resilient. Well, there's a problem, right? I went to graduate school for public administration. They didn't offer the course in resilience. I wish they offered the course in procurement, but they didn't do that either. But resilience is a new way of thinking. It's not something that Norfolk isn't doing, but it's a way of realigning what Norfolk is doing and taking it perhaps a step further. So how do we work with 100 cities? How do we start working with the 33 cities to begin to create this practice of resilience? Not just for a city, but also the practitioners. How do we create the CROs, the Chief Resilience Officers, who are the ones on the ground making and helping cities think about and become resilient? So the thought was we have to do a couple things. But before we start those couple of things, we're going to talk about what Rockefeller Foundation did first. They launched the Global Challenge, and the mayor alluded to this. So Global Challenge was launched last fall. 372 cities applied. Norfolk was one of those selected, and 33 were picked. As you can see, the mayor mentioned 11 are from the United States. The other 22 are from all over. They range in size from as small as Ramallah and Ashkelon and Byblos in the Middle East, which are just over 50,000 people, to the mega cities. I think Mexico City is the largest, but we have New York and Los Angeles and Rio and Bangkok. But all of these cities share a couple things in common. One, they're not the cities most in need, because if they were the most in need, it'd be real hard for us to create something new. These are all cities that express to us the need and the understanding of resilience. And they're also cities where the leadership said that they're willing to take the challenge and begin to build resilience in their city. It's also a great cross-section beyond size, but it's also a great cross-section of resilience challenges, of shocks and stresses. Many cities have water challenges, many cities are on seismic faults, many cities have cultural challenges, their buildings are falling down and they're ancient and they want to retain them. Many of them have economic challenges, a lot have crime and violence, many have new populations moving in. It's interesting when we put these cities all down how many similarities there are across them. And one of the things we're going to be doing is leveraging this network to begin to build solutions that work not just for Norfolk, but will work for Rotterdam, and that will work for Bangkok, and that will work for all these other cities in the water. It's really exciting for us as we do this. The mayor alluded to some of the reasons we picked Norfolk, but I want to just let you know and say it so you hear it from me. One of the things that the Norfolk application did that was great was it kind of started by admitting, you know, you have this great resource and you have this great problem, and that's your water, right? You're here because of your water, but you're in danger somewhat because of your water. And the mayor also alluded to this notion, perhaps because of the water and because of the way you're built, you're vulnerable to natural and man-made events. But one of the things that Norfolk did that not many other cities did is you highlighted the fact that none of this is new. This isn't something that came out of the last 50 years. This is what Norfolk's always had to face. And when you look at how Norfolk has grown up and the way the citizens are and the neighborhoods that are here, you see a resilient community. And you see a lot of things that you're already doing that are resilient. And these are the lessons that we want to cull from Norfolk and bring back to the network. And these are the kind of things that I get excited about being here and having the potential to work with you. And because of this recognition and the fact that you're resilient, you have strong communities and you have a strong history of disaster preparedness and the ability to communicate to your citizens in times of need. And then one of the things that all cities had was a strong support from the city leadership. Going into a city and trying to do this without the leadership would be foolish. And if I didn't make clear at the beginning, I'll make clear again now that, you know, the welcoming that we've gotten from the leadership at the Norfolk has been tremendous. It further reinforces our sense that Norfolk's going to be a really successful city in this exercise, and that the projects you're going to produce are going to be some that are going to be lessons for the world. So for that, I congratulate you, and we're very excited to work with you. But getting into what we're going to do with Norfolk is we're going to provide four types of assistance. So this is something we're going to do with every city. We're going to provide funding for a chief resilience officer. We're going to work with the city to develop a resilience strategy. We're going to provide resources to help you implement that strategy. And we're going to provide membership in the 100 Resilient Cities Network. So looking at this a little closer, each one, a chief resilience officer is going to be someone who has to have broad capabilities. In many ways, what we expect of a chief resilience officer is not something that can be in one person, but in a lot of ways has to be embodied by the whole community. The ability of someone to work across silos, across sectors, to rally the troops, to advise senior leadership, to go into communities and talk about the challenges of resilience, to really lead the city through the development of a strategy. Right, and then coordinate the different resources, and hopefully resources that maybe never participated in these type of solutions before, bring new resources to the table, and then find solutions, right? And the solutions will be partnering with us at 100 Resilient Cities, but it's not enough to say, wow, that's a cool tool. It's gonna be incumbent on that chief resilience officer to bring that tool into the city and have the city leverage that tool and utilize it to its fullest capacity. And then in addition, we're really going to be counting on the chief resilience officer to be a part of our global thought leadership and participate with all the other cities on creating the foundation in which the resilience, urban resilience programs are going to be built. So we expect a lot of that person, and we know we're going to get a really exciting person and partner. We're then going to work with the city on creating a strategy. So part of the strategy is first accepting that resilience is something that's important. The city started that when they sign up for the challenge. In many ways, us being here tonight is the next step in that challenge, but it's really just the beginning. Because what has to happen next is we need to begin to leverage all the work that has been done around resilience or resilience-like activities here in Norfolk, begin to understand how they fit together through the resilience lens, begin to think about what's missing, and begin to go out there and collect the data and get the information so we can create a comprehensive understanding of the challenges in Norfolk. And then begin to analyze and understand what the risks and opportunities are and how we want to attack the different shocks and stresses and how we want to build out these central functions of the city. That's going to be the prioritization that's going to come out of the strategy. And these are going to be the things that we're going to work to support you with through our platform of services. We know that cities already need help financing infrastructure projects that are going to help them build resilience. We know that data is becoming more and more a key component of any city doing its business. But it's not data as usual, it's data in the new usual. It's how do you leverage that data in these cool new tools that everyone else seems to be using but us, in a way that we can actually understand it and leverage to help us decide what projects are important, to help us understand perhaps in real time what resilience challenges we're facing on a day in and day out basis, and help us understand where we're going to be in the future so we can begin to invest smartly. Which also supports this notion of our policies and what are the rules and regulations that can be put in place that helps the city partner with the private sector and the citizens to help create resilience and build resilience from the ground up in every place we turn. And then fourth, we know there's going to be a need for tools to help build communities. While Norfolk has strong communities already, sometimes those actions aren't necessarily around specifically dealing with shocks and stresses. Sometimes it's not as overt as participating in building, enhancing livelihoods, and building greater resilience. So these are the kind of tools that we think are going to have to bear. But this is the thing we're listening to all 33 cities as they go through their strategy development. And we're going to reach out to every sector possible and bring back those resources so that we can begin to build the tools necessary for all the other cities in the world to become resilient, that we can create new financial instruments so that all the other cities in the world can begin to build resilience infrastructure. And finally, there's going to be the 100 Resilient Cities Network. This is going to be a global thought leadership, right? We're going to only go to 100, but this is the first 33. The ideas that we're developing over this first year are going to be the foundation and the bedrock. Many of them are going to be lessons learned, like here's how not to do this right. Some of them are going to be lessons learned, like, hey, I've already done this. Here's what we did in Norfolk. It worked really well. You should do this in Da Nang. And that's going to be the kind of tool that gets passed off and maybe gets enhanced, and maybe comes back to Norfolk in a new way. The ability to participate in that network is going to be critical for us developing the practice of resilience at both the city level and at the practitioner level. So I leave you with the last case study of the night. And this is an exciting case study. And in many ways, it's one that has a long history, but it's one that hasn't yet begun to happen. And it's the case study of Norfolk. How is Norfolk going to embrace resilience? Right? What are Norfolk's challenges going to be? And what are the creative solutions you're going to find? And how are you all here going to leave tonight and begin to think about how you personally and how you as a member of an organization and why you're here tonight can participate in building these essential functions? And how can you change the way your operation works and how you work and participate with the city as a whole and coordinate with the city as a whole to help build a city that is more adaptive, more robust, and integrated? So the challenge for everyone here is how are we going to build resilience together? I don't know what the answer is going to be, but I do know it's going to be a good one. And I know it starts tonight, and I want to call the mayor back up here, because this is the end of my presentation, and kind of say as a formal start to the building of resilience is we want to formally present you with this plaque, and I'll read it. It says, in recognition of your commitment to resilience, proudly named as a member of our network, the City of Norfolk, Virginia, December 3rd, 2013. So tonight's the first night, or perhaps the continuation of the first night of your building resilience. I'm really excited and I congratulate you very much, and I look forward to working with you.